optical brain imaging for innovation in neurotech. It has been a bit underestimated to date, but I believe had a lot of has a lot of potential and will, in my view, will very likely play a major role in the brain innovation field in the future. And in this talk, I actually want to explain to you why I believe that. But to begin with, first of all, there's of course EEG, which is a very scalable technology and also kind of dominates the field of brain innovation, particularly with consumer products and clinical products. And this actually has to do because in the last 10 years, there has been a lot of progress in the microelectronics and also in the developments of the sensor technology, and particularly the development of these dry electrodes that you can see there. Have made EEG a very scalable technology, and we have seen this rise in consumer and medical products. However, we also all know that EEG has its limitations. And actually, some of these limitations can be addressed by another technology, optical brain imaging. Also, for optical brain imaging, we have seen similar trends, like progress in the miniaturizations of the sensor technology, while also remaining low cost for its components, and the development of these portable and scalable devices that you can see there on the slides. Nevertheless, it still has been less exploited and disseminated today. So that's why today I want to talk about this technology a bit more, and kind of give you a better understanding how it works, what it is, what are the advantages, limitations, what are recent developments in the field, and also talk about applications to kind of give you a better understanding what we can use it for and what not in the near future. First to begin with, how does it work? So optical brain imaging, or functional near-infrared spectroscopy, which is the method of optical brain imaging that is most widely used, it uses near-infrared light to measure changes in cerebral blood flow and changes in oxygenated and deoxygenated hemoglobin. So it's like fMRI. It measures these hemodynamic response. So the idea is when the brain gets activated and needs more oxygen, and there's an increase of blood flow carrying the oxygen to the activated region, and this is what we can measure with fNIRS. Now, since near-infrared light is sensitive to changes in hemoglobin, we can actually use it to measure this effect. So we can place these sources and detectors on the head that you can see there, and then shine light into the brain through the scalp and skull, and then the light there scatters, but also some of the light gets absorbed by hemoglobin changes. So we can quantify these scattering and absorption effects and then create these images of brain activity. So what are the advantages, but also limitations and challenges? Let me start with the advantages. So as I already said, optical brain imaging is a very scalable technology. So it's really low cost. You can actually, it's actually cheaper than EEG. You can buy this very simple headband for even for less than $100, but there are no warranties. And it's also very safe, which is an advantage when it comes to regulations. It is also very easy to use, and the companies are making more and more progress in the usability also of the devices. It is also portable, there is no electromagnetic interference, and also other advantages over EEG is that it tolerates motions quite well and also has a higher spatial resolution. So in other words, this technology can actually be used by almost everywhere, also by everyone. There are almost no constraints with regard to potential use cases. Of course, there are also some limitations or challenges. And one is clear. So whenever we talk about brain imaging, also fMRI and EEG, but then also, of course also optical brain imaging, it's always a very noisy matter. And this is of course a challenge, because what we want, particularly for consumer products or clinical products, we want to achieve real-time detection of real brain activity in real people in the real world. But there are a number of sources of noise. Some of them we can handle quite well, some are more challenging. The first is physiological noise. So the fNIRS signal is contaminated by the heart rate signal, for example, but also by changes in blood pressure and respirations. So what can we do about it? We can, of course, co-record these noise sources and then pick the right pre-processing or denoising methods to control for that. And actually, the research community is also making more and more progress in this area and develop more and more sophisticated signal processing methods that you can use for these purposes. Then another problem is also there are individual differences. For example, it's the devices are less sensitive if you have dark, thick, long hair, or a darker skin color, or a very thick skull. And the only thing we can actually do about this is build more sensitive devices and improve the sensor technology. While FNIRS tolerates motions quite well, there are also limits to that, so you mustn't do head banging. But we can address this quite well through either good user instructions or also through co-recording the motion using an accelerometer and then regress it out of the signal. Lastly, there's also ambient light, so you need to shield your devices and your sensors from this ambient light that interferes with the signal. Now, what are developments? Now I will try to give you a better understanding how the field is progressing. So first thing, the imaging quality keeps getting better and better. And here you can see on the left side where we were 20 years ago. So this was a seminal study where they did single channel measurements and validated FNIRS against fMRI successfully. And on the right side, you can actually see what we have achieved today. So really 3D high density diffusion optical tomography, and we've made a lot of improvements. And some people already say that we are slowly approaching the imaging quality of fMRI. Now, progress has also been made in the development of different FNIRS methods, and this will allow us to do absolute measurement. But let me explain. So there are different FNIRS methods, and most FNIRS applications actually use continuous wave FNIRS, mainly because it's quite cheap and also very scalable. However, there's still the disadvantage that you can only measure relative changes compared to a baseline. So you can compare your measurements only within, but not between measurement days. However, there are also other methods, like, for example, time domain or frequency domain FNIRS. Here you can see time domain FNIRS, but this is still less established and also a bit more expensive, but it's also getting better. But this technology is actually capable of doing absolute measurements. And progress has also been made now since optical brain imaging has also caught the attention of some big players in the industry, as for example Cornell, who put a lot of money in developing new systems. And they have actually very recently developed the first scalable high-density time-domain FNIRS system that you can see there. And in the long run, they are actually also aiming for consumer applications. This will also lead to advancements and allow for more precise imaging and absolute measurements, and will open up the way also for new potential use cases in the future. There's of course also an open source movement and do-it-yourself kits that are published. This will also lead to advancements with more and more people getting their hands on an FNIRS device. And then also the last trend I want to highlight here is the trend or the vision of moving neuroscience to the everyday world, which is actually considered as one of the next frontiers of neuroscience. And indeed also thanks to some pioneers in the field like David Bowles from Boston University, also funders have started to embrace this vision. So funding is also increasing for developing new optical brain imaging systems. And as you can see here, as part of this, the research group at Boston University of David Bowles has received funding to develop these multimodal systems, so really that integrate different sensors, combining FNIRS with EEG, but also eye tracking and motion sensors in one wearable system. So this will lead to further advancement, not only in our understanding about the brain in everyday settings, but also open up the way for new potential applications. So what are these applications? Here you can see the applications. They are comparable to the ones of EEG, of course. And on the left side, you can see there are a lot of potential applications that are currently researched. But on the right side, you can also see that there are also already some products on the market, for example, neurofeedback products. And I will now highlight a few of these applications. So first of all, neurofeedback. So optical brain imaging has the potential for clinical translations of neurofeedback because it's so scalable and there's a lot of research going on. And actually, me and my colleagues have recently reviewed all of the studies in the field and published the first systematic review on Frontiers in Neuroscience. And what you can see here are kind of the results. So most of these studies have actually targeted prefrontal brain regions and targeted related functions like executive functions, but also threat processing and emotion regulations, and also explored clinical applications related to that. Also, some studies have targeted motor brain regions and actually provided very promising evidence for neurofeedback as a tool, as an additional tool for stroke rehabilitations. Lastly, some studies have also targeted cognitive functions in healthy people and explore neurofeedback as a tool for neuroenhancement or to prevent cognitive aging. Of note, of course, what we also found in our systematic review is that there was still quite a lot of room for improvement in the reporting and study quality. So the specificity still remains to be demonstrated for most of these cases before we can really talk about clinical utility. Another tangible applications are assistive brain-computer interfaces, so BCIs that are meant to assist you in daily life, for example, by measuring your mental workload. As this Canadian seed stage company Blueberry is doing. So what you can see here is their first prototype as an example. They have developed an FNIR sensor that you can just slide on your glasses or your earphones. And the idea is that this tracks your mental workload using this FNIR sensor, but also using a motion sensor. And then provide you with real-time feedback of your mental workload and during daily life activities to kind of help you adjust and remain in an optimal state of mental workload. Of course, for such an applications, you need very reliable measurements of sufficient quality. So yeah, it will be interesting to see what they can achieve. And also in this regard, these multimodal systems might be helpful since there is some evidence that multimodal BCI systems that combine FNIRs with EEG allow for more precise classifications of mental workload. So the last applications are BCIs for communications, for example, to build these spelling devices for patients in the locked-in state. And yeah, they're mostly EEG studies, but also the first FNIR studies have been published that also show the feasibility and also point towards comparable classification accuracy as with EEG. Again, multimodal measurements may lead to further improvements of the systems here. Lastly is something that doesn't work. You may have heard about the example of Facebook. They also tried to use optical brain imaging to build these mind reading devices. So to have a consumer device that kind of directly spells from your brain, or also Neuralink is trying to achieve, but they were not successful. So they actually did their plans to make such an interface because for real-time language decoding, you really need a better and faster signal. So when you really want to decode like thousands of words and not a simple binary yes or no classification as you need for these spelling devices. So yeah, this doesn't work. Now to recap, so I hope I could show you that the field is gaining a lot of traction and the developments are very fast, and these developments will certainly further build on the advantages of optical brain imaging but also address its challenges and limitations. And we already see some applications and also some products on the market, and more and more potential future applications will be researched. Yes, so optical brain imaging will very likely play a major role in the brain innovation field, I believe, and hopefully also help us to find new treatments and also improve the lives of people with brain disorders. So, yeah, thanks a lot for your attention. I really tried to cover quite a lot in this short talk. So, yeah, if you have any more questions, if I could catch your interest, just you can also speak to me or to my co-founder, Sophie Estera, during the coffee breaks. Thanks.